Let me hear in the morning of thy steadfast love, for in thee I put my trust. Teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God.
May your spirit guide me.
Merciful God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess
that we are bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved
you with our whole heart.
We have not
loved our neighbors as ourselves.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, lead us, so that we may be life. Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. We are made God's people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again.
Also an altar with its inscription. enshrined to be by people, nor has this God served by human hands, as though the Lord needed anything, since God himself gives to all people life and breath and everything. And God made from one a creation of people to live on all the face of the earth, having determined a lot of periods and the boundaries of their habitation, that they should seek God in the hope that they might feel after God and find God. If God is not far from each one of us, Lord, in God we live and move and have our being, as even some of your poets have said, for we are indeed God's offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or a stone, a representation by the art and imagination of people. The time of ignorance God overlooked, but not God commands all people everywhere to repent. Because God has fixed a day on which God will judge the world in righteousness. By a man whom God has appointed, and of this God has given assurance to all people by raising him from the dead.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. There are many questions that could reasonably interest and even exercise seniors and friends on a day of graduation, of leaving, and of beginning. There is one question presented by one of the texts for today that is suited particularly, it seems to me, for a college of the church. And so we ask together in our last worship service together, what can we say about God? Our text, Acts 17, has already been read, and I would like to put some context to that by reading the verses immediately preceding it and perhaps reading the better part of the text again. Now, when Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city was full of idols. So he argued in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and in the marketplace every day with those who chanced to be there. Some also of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers met him, and some said, "What would this babbler say?" Others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities, because he preached Jesus and the resurrection." And they took hold of him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is which you present, for you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new. So Paul, standing in the middle of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you: the God who made the world and everything in it, being the Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all persons life and breath and everything. And he made from one every nation of men to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their allotted periods and the boundaries of their habitation, that they should seek God in the hope that they might feel after him and find him. Yet he is not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, a representation by the art and imagination of man. The times of ignorance God has overlooked, but now he commands all persons everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all persons by raising him from the dead." Now when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, but others said, "We will hear of you again about this." So Paul went out from among them. But some men joined him and believed, among them Dionysius the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. If we should put our question, "What should we say about God?" to the Athenians, they would respond that the question itself is wrong, for there are many gods, not just one. While some would argue that there is really only Zeus in charge, or that reason or providence are the true gods, others had gods for every occasion and activity. And Paul, as we read, was dismayed and outraged at the number of idols in the city, from powerful Zeus with his many sexual partners to crippled Hephaestus, from Athena and to Aphrodite, from Ares to Hermes, Poseidon, Dionysus, there were gods for everyone's taste and desire and fears. Athens was also a place where philosophy served as a demigod for many, while second rate in political or military senses, the city still breathed the heady atmosphere of being an intellectual capital. Although it has to be admitted that the winds of change were dissipating the force of this reputation also. Schools of thinkers continued to search out for something new in good Athenian fashion. 300 years earlier, Demosthenes had chided the people of this city when he said, "Instead of guarding your liberties, you are forever gadding about looking for something new." There were the Stoics and the Epicureans that are mentioned in this text, but also followers of Plato and Aristotle. There were the Cynics and the Eclectics. And while some of them would argue that God or gods do not exist, St. Paul was speaking to the common position when he observed, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious." Some Epicureans believe that the gods exist and are happy among themselves but have no contact with humans. That is, they exist but don't care about the world. Others found an ordering principle in reason or providence that they felt guided the ways of humans, and still others trembled before the apparent capriciousness of the gods, who were kind and beneficent one moment and cruel and destructive the next. What can you say about God, Athenians? By the number and the variety of their responses, it is obvious that they didn't know what to say. They furnished powerful expression, however, of their religious ignorance and their religious longings by having an altar dedicated to an unknown God. In the context of theological debate and philosophical discourse, in the context of a search for something intellectually new and stimulating, and in the midst of a town full of idols, they had an altar to an unknown God. Perhaps it was reverence for the unknown, but perhaps only fire insurance. Like the man who wants to be really safe and so wears both suspenders and a belt. That is, if it's not really Zeus who is in charge, then let's cover all the bases and be polite to whomever it is. I find the situation of this text and the response it evokes quite similar to our own time. Ours is a religious age. The practice of religion in its many forms is once again on the increase, according to the Gallup polls. While it might be argued that for some persons it is the form of religion rather than the substance of the faith that dominates, still we are, like the Athenians, very religious. But what can we say about God? Madeline Murray O'Hare has one answer. Each week on cable television, she tells us there is no God and that history has been unbelievably marred for generations in the name of this non-existent deity. Marxism argues that religion is the opiate of the people and argues for an atheistic state and culture. A deist, on the other hand, would present another view. It would be argued that there is a God who has created the universe, but having done this, he or she has, in a sense, spun the world off into space and is now no more in contact with it. The world is on its own, running on forever, says the optimist, or running down inexorably, says the pessimist. Other persons today would argue that God exists and is involved in the creation, but this involvement is terribly arbitrary and uncertain, merciful one moment and unbelievably hurtful and destructive the next. As Shakespeare put it, as flies to wanton boys, they torture us for sport. The essential characteristic of God to another position is anger. His is the mighty arm waiting to destroy, the hand that is poised to punish. We are indeed, as was put by an early preacher, sinners in the hands of an angry God, guilty and subject to death. All of these positions, except for the atheist, share in their attempt to determine what God is like by the use of reason in the study of the world of nature. And the conclusion is that the deity is either withdrawn and inactive or involved, but in a terribly idiosyncratic and capricious manner. We are either free agents, as the deist position argues, or pawns moved about in a seemingly purposeless manner by an angry God. Our reactions to this news range from the apathy and disinterest of the serene secularist for whom the world free of God is home, with human beings the measure of all things. They ranged from that response to that of the fearful slave, anxious to placate a deity whose anger we don't really understand but can surely sense and suffer. There are other modern variations, of course. Some persons, in a reversal of the biblical statement that God has made us in his image, have reversed and made God in their image. And so God is seen, for example, as a cosmic and eternal terrorist, extorting millions from the friends of Oral Roberts. Or he's seen as a tradesman, selling good fortune and financial success and physical health for a contribution to the Baker or the Swaggart family. Or at the very last, we can stand with the agnostic, who would say we cannot know God, nor even know whether one exists, and so we should try to lead as moral a life as our neighbor, try to be good, and in our hearts have an altar to an unknown God. Actually, the altar to an unknown God could suit everyone on our list. The atheist would say, if there is no God, then what is lost by this meaningless gesture? The deist could say God exists, but no personal contact or knowing is possible. And the unpredictable God of nature is certainly unknown, only feared, as is the God of wrath. What we need in that context is an altar of some sort to placate this being, or at least ease our own tensions. The preaching of Paul to the Athenians, while not a signal success in terms of numbers of persons persuaded, was a masterpiece of context and interpretation. He seized upon the very religiousness of the people and the existence of that special altar. "Haven't you ever wondered," he implied, "who it is that you unknowingly worship here? It is not the gods of which you make idols of gold and silver. In fact, it is he who has made you and all creation, and allotted to us our time and space." In contrast to the Epicureans, who held that the cosmos emerged as atoms came together by accident, or the Stoics, who held that matter itself was eternal and that the gods simply shaped it into a whole, Paul insists that this unknown God created purposefully, and that he sustains his creation. "We seek him," he says, "from afar, but he is not far from each of us. In fact, your own poets," he says, "have said as much. Your times of ignorance, your lack of knowing have been overlooked. But now is the time for everyone to turn around and come back from the old days. There will be judgment by an appointed one. We can be sure of this, because God has raised his chosen from the dead." The sermon was over. The unknown God had been revealed. In contrast to the disengaged deities and the accidental character of the cosmos of the Epicureans, this God is involved with the creation which he purposed and sustained. In contrast to the deities who are made of silver and gold by human hands, this God himself has made all things. In contrast to the wrathful pictures, this God has shown mercy for generations, overlooking the ignorance of the Athenians, and only now calls for repentance in these last days. In contrast to these positions, the text says Paul preached Jesus and the resurrection, but his hearers turned away, and many mocked. Later, writing to the Corinthians and perhaps remembering this event, Paul noted, "The word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God." How does one know God in Paul's day or ours? The paths of nature and reason continue to lead to agnosticism, or at best to a picture of wrath and caprice. God has hidden himself in the world and the created order, and his secrets are not to be pried out. Luther once suggested that we should not try to climb up the back steps of heaven by our reason to try to pry out the secrets of God. Rather, he said, we must begin, if we would be safe, where he began, in the manger. It is in the precise spot and time that God has chosen that he becomes known, not as our creation or image, but as creator and sustainer and savior. For when the time had fully come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. The gospel text assigned for today speaks powerfully of another dimension of this knowing. Jesus promises to those who love him another counselor, the Spirit of truth, who will be with them forever. You know him, he says, for he dwells with you and will be in you. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. The search is over. The promise is among and within us in divine love. And so also the epistle for today, 1 Peter 3, takes our knowing of God one step further and speaks of doing, of communicating the faith within us as it speaks in your heart's reverence, Christ as Lord, that is God. And be ready to state your position and to suffer, if necessary, for it. What can we say about God? The secret is out. God is not hidden or absent. He wills to be known in the person of Jesus Christ and by the power of the Holy Spirit. We know God in Jesus Christ and his forgiving work. We meet God today in the needs of our neighbors. We thank and praise God as we serve the neighbor, reverencing Christ as Lord and speaking his truth in love. Our actions today in a little while in beginning a building to the greater glory of God are an affirmation of faithful speaking and doing, of communication, of holding the mirror up to life in drama, and in responding in worship to the God we know in Jesus Christ. Luther once asked in the Large Catechism, what is it to have a God? What is God? And he answered, a God is that to which we look for all good and in which we find refuge in every time of need. That to which your heart clings and entrusts itself is, I say, really your God. What can we say about God? Only what we have been told and seen in the life and the promise and the face of Jesus. And that is enough. Amen.
to seek your will, and the commitment of faith which makes love for all humankind a possibility.
Create us to be shaped by your creative word.
We are deeply aware of the support and encouragement of the parents, spouses, families, and friends of those who graduate today, and of those who have taught and given them counsel.
We give you thanks for that.
These concerns and the unspoken prayers of all of us grant, O God, for his sake, who died and rose again, who now lives and rules with you in the oneness of the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end.